Has America's overdose crisis been caused by doctors overtreating patients with opioids? That was the subject of this month's Soho Forum debate held at the Sheen Center in downtown Manhattan. Adriane Fugh-Berman defended the proposition. She's a medical doctor and a professor of pharmacology and physiology at Georgetown University Medical Center. She argued that the overdose crisis traces back to pharmaceutical companies convincing doctors that opioids were safe and effective, causing rising rates of addiction. Dr. Jeffrey Singer, a surgeon and senior fellow at the Cato Institute, took the negative. He argued that the rate of overdoses and the rate at which doctors prescribe opioids aren't correlated. The real culprit, he said, was drug prohibition. This debate was moderated by Soho Forum Director Gene Epstein.
Defending the resolution, Adriane Fugh-Berman. Adriane, please come to the stage. Taking the negative on the resolution, Jeff Singer. Jeff, please come to the stage. Jane, please close the voting. Adriane, you have 17 and a half minutes to defend the resolution and to take this podium. Take it away, Adriane.
Good evening, and thank you so much for being here to discuss this important question. My conflict of interest disclosure is that I'm a paid expert witness at the request of plaintiffs in litigation regarding pharmaceutical marketing practices. Probably everyone in this audience knows someone in their circle who became addicted to opioids or died from an opioid overdose. I'm going to explain how so many people in the US got hooked on opioids, how physicians contributed to the opioid epidemic, and how doctors' false beliefs about opioids were manipulated by the pharmaceutical industry. Although physicians didn't single-handedly cause the opioid epidemic, they were cleverly manipulated by pharmaceutical companies to become the primary contributor to the crisis of addiction and overdose that we have today. Opioids are excellent drugs for end-of-life care and cancer-related pain and for acute pain. Up until the 1990s, that's what they were used for. Physicians were once cautious about opioids and almost never prescribed them for arthritis or low back pain. Opioid manufacturers set out to change that. They promoted opioids by exaggerating the prevalence of and the importance of untreated pain. They constantly cited this study here, even though the authors of this study protested that the study made no distinction between chronic severe pain and everyday aches and pains. Pharmaceutical companies convinced physicians against the evidence that opioids were safe and effective for chronic pain. Including low back pain, arthritis, fibromyalgia, and irritable bowel syndrome. They used physician influencers called key opinion leaders, and they pressured physicians into prescribing opioids, even if they were reluctant to do so. They called them opiophobic. And they claimed that they were withholding the best pain medication from their patients with chronic pain. Physicians aren't bad people. We want to help patients. It was a very persuasive argument to tell us that we were torturing our patients by withholding the best pain medication from them. This argument worked really well. They used drug reps, influencers, professional organizations, educational events, and articles in medical journals to convince physicians that long-term treatment of chronic pain rarely resulted in addiction and that it was effective and safe. In fact, it was neither. It turns out that opioids are the worst drugs for chronic pain, not just because they're addictive, they don't work for chronic pain. This is a systematic review of 96 randomized controlled trials that found that opioids are better than placebo, a little better than placebo for treating pain, and they're about as good as ibuprofen and related drugs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, for improving pain and improving function. If you combine opioids and NSAIDs, you don't get additional relief from the opioids, but you do get more adverse effects. Unfortunately, opioids can make pain worse. They can cause hyperalgesia, which is an increased sensitivity to pain. And some pain patients actually develop, even light touch will be painful to them. In many cases, lowering the dose of opioids in chronic pain patients will actually improve pain. Even though opioids generally don't help chronic pain. They're unbelievably difficult to quit. Withdrawal is a horrible thing to go through. It's physically painful. And the other symptoms include diarrhea, vomiting, light sensitivity, sweating, rapid heartbeat, rapid breathing, high blood pressure, anxiety, and what one ex-addict has called psychic death. People who are addicted to opioids don't continue to use them because they feel good or to get high. They use them to avoid the horrors of withdrawal. And while acute withdrawal can last days or weeks, many patients will have some symptoms, including depression, fatigue, insomnia, restless leg syndrome, for 6 months or longer. It's not a short-term thing. The expansion of the use of opioids from cancer-related pain and end-of-life care to the treatment of back pain and arthritis and other conditions for which they should never have been prescribed has resulted in hundreds of thousands of deaths and millions of shattered lives. In 30 years, about 250,000 Americans died specifically from overdosing from prescription opioids. And in the 20 years up to 2019, overdose deaths involving prescription opioids more than quadrupled. And that's gotten even worse. Last year, there were more than 107,000 overdose deaths, and 75% of them involved an opioid. Now, opioid sales track quite closely to both opioid deaths and hospitalizations for opioid use disorder. And the deaths are really just the tip of the iceberg. Besides addiction, besides overdose, opioids cause severe depression, including an increased risk of suicide, respiratory depression or suppressed breathing, and many other things. We talked about hyperalgesia, cardiovascular events, immune suppression, not a particularly good thing in terms of COVID. And just in terms of the treatment costs of opioid addiction and overdose, it's $1 billion a year in 2017. And that doesn't include the other costs of addiction, the loss of jobs, the loss of relationships, babies that are born dependent on opioids, kids ending up in foster care. It doesn't include any of those societal costs. So even a few days of opioids can cause problems. So people think, you know, a couple of days doesn't matter. 6% of patients who take opioids for 1 day are still using opioids a year later. And about 30% of patients who use opioids for a month are still taking opioids a year later. And these are some other studies. Even every additional day that somebody is taking an opioid increases the chances that they will be on those opioids chronically. And after surgery, about 6% of people become chronic opioid users. So these short courses of opioids end up becoming long courses. And long-term use is common in people who start on opioids. Now, my opponent will tell you that addiction is rare in long-term opioid users. That's because he apparently has fallen for fairy tales spread by opioid manufacturers who lied about addiction risk, saying that only 1% of patients become addicted. There's no reliable evidence that supports these claims. Opioid manufacturer drug reps told physicians that there was less than 1% of patients who became addicted, but in fact, a drug company study, Purdue, which makes OxyContin, found that even in their own study, 13% of people became addicted. That 1% number comes from this one paragraph, Porter and Jick letter in the New England Journal of Medicine, in which they looked at hospital records in which someone had taken at least one dose of opioids and was addiction actually mentioned in the record. This study is not worth the paper that it's printed on. But the use of this study and that lie about the 1% addiction rate was all part of a marketing strategy by the Sacklers, Purdue Pharmaceuticals, but also other opioid manufacturers as well. In documents that have been exposed in litigation, Richard Sackler said, "We have to hammer on the abusers in every way possible. They're the culprits. They're the problem. They are reckless criminals." And other documents show that it was a marketing message to say, it's not addiction, it's abuse. It's about personal responsibility. Because separating abusers, the so-called abusers, from the so-called legitimate pain patients was a marketing tactic. And some physicians were realizing that their patients were becoming addicted. So they were convinced, okay, I'm underusing opioids. I don't want to torture my patients. I'm giving them opioids. And they were noticing that their patients were coming in demanding higher and higher doses and manifesting symptoms of addiction. So a Purdue employee, David Haddix, came up with the term pseudo-addiction. Now, all of the symptoms of pseudo-addiction are exactly the same as addiction, but they're not really due to addiction, they're due to untreated pain, so it's okay to just keep increasing the doses of opioids in those patients. So there's no evidence for pseudo-addiction, it's just addiction renamed. But the term pseudo-addiction, it eased prescribers' guilt, it eased their concern. They're seeing a patient who seems to be addicted and they're being told, oh, they just have undertreated pain. If you increase the dose of opioids and the symptoms go away, then it must be pseudo-addiction. Other terms that were co-opted by opioid manufacturers included dependence and tolerance, which were soothingly described as normal, adaptive states. The words dependence and tolerance enabled physicians to overlook the warning signs of addiction. And then when somebody became frankly addicted, then they were called pseudo-addiction, and physicians had permission to keep raising opioid doses. When a physician could no longer delude themselves that their patient was addicted, the patient might decide that patient's no longer a legitimate pain patient, that patient is an abuser, might cut them off of opioids. An awful thing to do to someone dependent on opioids. No one should ever be taken off of opioids suddenly who's a chronic user. It's inhumane. Most patients who are on chronic opioids need to be tapered very slowly. Even then, it's an extremely difficult process, and many people will remain on opioids for their entire lives. It's not only abusers who become addicted. All opioids are addictive, and there's no human that is immune from addiction. Everyone's susceptible. Addiction's common among people on chronic opioids. 8 to 12% of people with chronic pain become addicted. Other studies have found that a third of chronic pain patients meet criteria for opioid use disorder. Addiction is common among, among people with back pain or other types of chronic pain. So opioid manufacturers underplayed addiction risks, and physicians played along. They really became these unwitting drug dealers. These, again, are the symptoms of withdrawal. Patients who are undergoing these symptoms can't use reason. These symptoms do away with autonomy. It becomes very difficult to make a rational decision about quitting when bodily fluids are flowing out of your eyes, nose, mouth, skin, and intestine. Pain racks your body, and you feel like you're going to die. Now today, most deaths from opioids are due to fentanyl and street drugs. However, many users of heroin and fentanyl started out with prescription opioids. Here's the sequence. First, the physician prescribes opioids that may or may that are probably not needed. Then patients become dependent. And then maybe the physician gets nervous and cuts them off of opioids, or maybe the prescription opioids become too expensive. Heroin's quite cheap. Then the patient turns to street drugs. The epidemic of fentanyl overdoses cannot be disentangled from the prescription opioid epidemic because prescription drug use leads to heroin use, which then exposes people to the risks of fentanyl that are lacing the heroin supply. Between 4 and 8 out of 10 heroin users started with prescription opioids. And if someone who was prescribed opioids before has a risk of heroin use, that's 19 times higher. And about 5% of people who first misuse prescription opioids will go on to use heroin. So most heroin users started off with prescription opioids. adolescents are particularly prone to addiction. The human brain doesn't fully mature until about 24 years old, kind of explains a lot. So adolescents are much more prone to become addicted. And adolescents who are given a prescription opioid, most of them from a healthcare provider, were at 3 to 4 times the risk of heroin initiation. My opponent may imply that a generous hand with prescription opioids will protect people, but it's not actually true. Many people on heroin actually were prescribed an opioid within the past year. So this is a report from the Agency for Healthcare Research on Quality that shows that opioids are less effective than Tylenol or ibuprofen for kidney pain. So even for acute pain, opioids are not always necessary. They're less effective than non-steroidal anti-inflammatories for dental pain. And by the way, dentists are the sixth highest prescriber of opioids and the number one prescriber to adolescents who are more likely to get addicted. After surgery, patients don't need as many opioids as surgeons are prescribing. In fact, many people end up with unused opioids. Up to 71% of opioids aren't used. But you know, people aren't throwing away those opioids. They're sort of intrinsically valuable. They put them in the medicine cabinet where their kids' friends, their house guests can get them. So that overprescription contributes to addiction among people, even the ones who weren't prescribed the drugs. The U.S. has prescribed more opioids than any other country since 1992. Opioid prescription has gone down some between 2009 and 2019, but we're still in the top three countries. We're still prescribing opioids inappropriately. A quarter of the people who go to the ER with a sprained ankle get an opioid. Half of women who have normal vaginal childbirth get opioids afterward. Some of these people are going to end up addicted to opioids that they were taking exactly as prescribed. Even children get opioids. In 2019, in 28 children and young adults under 21 got an opioid prescription. 41% got more than a 3-day supply. Dentists and surgeons wrote most prescriptions. So how did physicians get yoked into helping opioid manufacturers make billions of dollars in profits? Well, promotion works. These are some of the things that go into promotion. KOLs are influencers, key opinion leaders. And studies show that the more drug reps visit doctors, the more opioids they prescribe, the more meals they give, the more gifts they give, the more payments, the more a physician describes. And meals even have a dose-related effect. Every meal given to a prescriber results in a 0.7% increase in opioid prescribing. Now, opioid prescribing has gone down among physicians, but only the ones who aren't taking any gifts or payments from opioid manufacturers. 1 in 12 physicians takes money from opioid manufacturers. And among physicians who take money from opioid manufacturers, actually are more likely to prescribe opioids. And anyway, overdose mortality increases significantly related to dollars received. So overdose deaths are actually, opioid promotion actually increases deaths. And restricting interactions with industry reduces opioid prescribing, but unfortunately, a lot of the continuing medical education that doctors get is provided by industry, and it always promotes the drugs. We've done a lot of research on that. In conclusion, opioids are the main driver of overdose deaths in the United States, and physicians are the main supplier of the initial opioids that hook people. People who overdosed on street opioids started their habit with opioids prescribed by their physicians. Many patients became addicted after taking prescription opioids, even the ones who took them exactly as prescribed. Others became addicted on pills left over from overprescription. Physicians became unwitting accomplices to opioid manufacturers in increasing and normalizing the use of opioids in the U.S. Many doctors, meaning no harm, inadvertently addicted patients to opioids. We would not have this crisis of opioid addiction and death we have today if it were not for doctors overtreating patients with opioids. Thank you.
Jeff Singer, for the negative, take it away, Jeff.
I'd like to thank Gene and the Soho Forum for organizing this important debate and Dr. Fugh-Berman for agreeing to participate. When overdose deaths were mainly associated with minority, urban, and marginalized communities in the 1970s, 80s, and early 90s, they were considered the user's fault. They were immoral and made bad choices. When white middle class people became more prominent among the overdose death numbers, they were considered victims of the pharmaceutical industry and doctors. Policymakers and opinion leaders have never placed the blame where it has always belonged, on drug prohibition. This is not an opioid crisis. It's not even a fentanyl crisis. It's a prohibition crisis. And failure to recognize this fact is making patients suffer needlessly while causing overdose deaths to increase. Now, I'm not here to defend the business and marketing practices of the pharmaceutical companies, nor am I here to defend a particular approach to the treatment of acute or chronic pain. I don't know if Dr. Fugh-Berman is a clinician like me, or if she primarily focuses on medical research and expert testimony, but as a medical doctor, I trust she would agree there are always robust debates among clinicians regarding the proper and rational treatment of a host of conditions, from high blood pressure to diabetes to acute and chronic pain, and that patients in their clinical context vary, that there is no one right way to treat a wide range of medical conditions, that treatment must be individualized, and clinicians must remain open to modifications and adjustments along the way. But these are topics for a different debate and perhaps a different forum. When I discussed this issue in 2018, the CDC reported roughly 47,000 opioid-related overdose deaths, and a prescription opioid dispensing rate of just over 51 per 100 persons. And 66% of opioid-related overdose deaths that year involved illicit fentanyl. By the end of 2020, the dispensing rate had dropped to 43 per 100, while the opioid-related overdose death rate topped 71,000, 83% of which involved illicit fentanyl. We recently had the devastating report of roughly 108,000 total overdose deaths in 2021, 77,000 of which involved opioids of all types, 87% of those involved fentanyl. Prescribing rates and overdose deaths obviously aren't correlated. Researchers at the University of Pittsburgh and the CDC reported in 2018 that drug overdoses have been growing exponentially since at least the late 1970s, well before the FDA approved OxyContin in 1996. Their study concludes, quote, "The U.S. drug overdose epidemic has been inexorably tracking along an exponential growth curve since at least 1979. This historical pattern of predictable growth for at least 38 years suggests that the current opioid epidemic may be a more recent manifestation of an ongoing, longer-term process. This process may continue along this path for several more years into the future." End of quote. It's just common sense that if overdose deaths were occurring years before opioids were widely used for treatment, then the treatment, the opioid prescriptions, does not explain the deaths. Effect does not precede cause. While these researchers were only able to track the rise in overdose deaths back to 1979, a 2019 report by the Joint Economic Committee of Congress found overdose deaths began to rise as early as 1959. When I began my surgical practice in the 1980s, both doctors and patients feared opioids, and pain went undertreated. By the late 1980s, as research suggested that opioids had a low addictive potential and overdose potential, doctors were encouraged to overcome that fear. In fact, in 1989, National Institute on Drug Abuse Director Charles Schuster stated, quote, "We have endowed these drugs with a mysterious power to enslave that has been overrated," close quote. And in 1993, National Institute on Drug Abuse newsletter stated, quote, "These drugs are rarely abused for medical purposes. Thousands of patients suffer needlessly," close quote. That's 1993. Now, many people, including apparently my opponent, wrongly confuse chemical dependence and addiction, and some doctors are guilty of this, doing this as well, but they are different. Dependence refers to the body's adaptation to a drug such that abrupt cessation can cause withdrawal symptoms. Opioids are among those drugs that can cause dependence, but they are far from the only drugs to do so. Many drugs fit this description. Beta blockers used to treat hypertension create dependence, and abrupt cessation can cause a fatal withdrawal reaction. Anti-epileptic drugs also generate dependence. Same with antidepressants. Would anybody suggest a person whose blood pressure is being well controlled with a beta blocker is a beta blocker addict? Let me take it a step further. Would anyone suggest that because a patient has been on a beta blocker for a long time and has been doing its intended job, the patient must be taken off it because their body developed a dependence on the drug? Yet this is what is now being said about chronic pain patients who've had their pain controlled for several years with ongoing opioid treatment. While dependence is physiological, addiction is behavioral. Addiction is defined as compulsive use despite negative consequences. Addiction is a compulsive behavior disorder in which a person develops an unhealthy relationship with the drug. The person becomes addicted to the drug doesn't addict the person. And this term doesn't only apply to substances, such as alcohol addiction, but to behaviors as well, such as gambling addiction, shopping addiction, sex addiction. As recently as 2016, in the New England Journal of Medicine article, Drs. Nora Volkow and Thomas McClellan, the director and deputy director of the National Institute on Drug Abuse Today, said, reported, quote, "Unlike tolerance and physical dependence, addiction is not a predictable result of opioid prescribing. Addiction only occurs in a small percentage of persons who are exposed to opioids, even among those with pre-existing vulnerabilities," close quote. Multiple Cochrane studies, the most respected and rigorous reviews on medical literature, show addiction to prescription opioids in chronic pain patients is very uncommon. According to the debate's resolution, overprescribing opioids caused an epidemic of opioid addiction, which in turn caused the overdose crisis. How do I make the slide work here? I'm trying. Did it come on? Okay, is this the first slide? Yeah. I think, make sure it's the first slide. Yeah, I guess it is, okay. So this is from the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, which is conducted by the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. It shows the trends in substance use disorder among adults from 2002 to 2014. After 2014, they changed the nomenclature and terminology of their questionnaire. The blue line represents alcohol use disorder, and the green line represents all illicit drugs. See if I get the next slide to advance. Yeah, well, I want to go back. Okay, now, this slide breaks down the trend by specific drugs. The blue line represents prescription pain pills. The green line is cocaine. The orange line at the bottom is heroin. And the red line at the top is cannabis. Now, I'm not an epidemiologist, but I studied epidemiology in medical school. And I seem to recall that an epidemic would require they essentially flat line that charts the percentage of adults with addiction to prescription drugs to go up somewhere along that timeline. For the resolution to make sense, this line cannot be flat. In January 2019, I co-authored a paper with Dr. Michael Chapman of Tufts University and Jacob Sullum of Reason Magazine. Published in the Journal of Pain Research, it used CDC and other data from 2002 to 2014. Bottom line, during that decade, per capita pain reliever prescriptions doubled, while non-medical use of prescription pain relievers and addiction to pain relievers was unchanged. There is no correlation between prescription volume and non-medical use of addiction to prescription pain pills. Let me share just a few more important facts with the audience. The National Survey on Drug Use and Health consistently shows roughly one quarter of non-medical users of prescription pain pills got their drugs from a doctor. Three quarters, the large majority, get them from a friend, a relative, or a dealer. A 2007 study in the American Journal of Psychiatry found that 78% of OxyContin addicts admitted to rehab got their OxyContin from a friend, a relative, or a dealer, and 78% also had reported prior treatment for substance use disorder. And 92% of them reported poly drug use, most commonly with cocaine. The overwhelming majority of drug overdose deaths have been what's so-called poly drug deaths, with substances such as cocaine, meth, Xanax, and alcohol. The New York City Department of Health concluded over 97% of overdoses had multiple drugs on board. By 2017, the CDC reported that fewer than 10% of overdoses involved prescription opioids alone without these other dangerous substances. A 2019 study in North Carolina found at least three quarters of North Carolina opioid-related overdose deaths involved cocaine, meth, and alcohol. Now, clearly, if the opioid overdose deaths were due to overprescribing opioids, the bodies would contain opioids. Doctors are not prescribing poly drug cocktails. We're not prescribing to our patients opioids plus cocaine plus meth plus alcohol. And why would a dependence on opioids compel a person to use them with cocaine, meth, Xanax, and alcohol? A study by researchers at Harvard and Johns Hopkins published in the BMJ in 2018 followed over 500,000 patients treated with opioids for acute postoperative pain between 2008 and 2016. Contrary to what my opponent said, they found a total misuse rate of 0.6%, and that was over 500,000 patients followed in the Aetna database. Cicero and others at Washington University in St. Louis found that 33% of heroin addicts admitted for drug rehab in 2015 stated they initiated non-medical drug use with heroin. Heroin was their gateway drug. 9% said that in 2005 to Cicero. So heroin addicts seem to be increasing all on their own without the help of physician prescribers. And by the way, the study referred to earlier that said most heroin addicts start with prescription opioids, that's true, but it's misleading. They start with diverted prescription opioids that they were using recreationally with their friends. They didn't start as patients. Study after study finds the overdose rate from prescription opioids taken in a medical setting ranges either from 0.022% to 0.04%. Listen to this one. Seniors over age 65 are prescribed opioids 60% more often than young adults aged 25 to 34, yet young adults die from overdoses 4 times more often than seniors. So where does this leave us? Drug prohibition makes non-medical use of drugs more dangerous because the black market is a dangerous place to buy drugs. They may be adulterated, and adults' impurity are not assured. There's also something that economists call the iron law of prohibition. As law enforcement becomes more intense, the potency of the prohibited substance increases. The more potent a drug is, the more bang for the buck, the smaller the volume it takes for a given high, and thus the easier it is to hide from law enforcement. Basically, the harder the law, the harder the drug. The iron law explains why cannabis has become more potent over the years, and why crack cocaine was even developed, why phenyl-2-propanone was found as a way to produce more potent mixtures of meth, and it's why fentanyl is replacing heroin. Non-medical drug use has been on the increase for decades, we now learn, and in recent years, people appear more willing to take risks with drug use than did earlier generations of drug users. Why? Frankly, no one knows for sure, and speculation on the answer draws us far afield from the debate topic. But we do know that in the late 1990s and early 2000s, as opioids became more liberally prescribed, more prescription opioids were diverted into the black market for non-medical use, whether it's recreational or self-medication. Was that a bad thing? We can argue the point, but quite frankly, as a medical doctor committed to harm reduction, I would prefer non-medical users to use diverted pharmaceutical-grade prescription opioids. We know what they are, what they say they are, the dose is what it says on the bottle, and there's no concern that they may be laced with something. As the blame for the overdose crisis shifted to opioid prescribing, prescribing rates came way down. As a result, non-medical users shifted to the next best thing. First heroin, then heroin and fentanyl. This slide shows CDC data through 2016 before fentanyl became predominant. In this slide, the red line represents prescription volume. The green line represents overdose deaths from all opioids. The blue line represents overdoses from prescription opioids. The forest green line represents heroin, and the orange line represents fentanyl. Notice how as prescriptions come down, overdoses go up. To be accurate, by the way, research from UC San Francisco suggests that most non-medical opioid users don't prefer fentanyl. They view it as a contaminant. They prefer heroin or diverted prescription pain pills, but the dangerous black market doesn't give them many options. Shopping for illicit drugs is not like shopping on Amazon. Now, this next slide is from the CDC at the end of 2020. There were 93,000 total overdose deaths, 68,000 were opioid related. And by that time, fentanyl was involved in 83% of overdose deaths. Fentanyl is the orange line in this slide. Prescription pain pills are represented by that light green flat line near the very bottom. And pain patients are the collateral damage in this misguided war on opioids. Demonizing prescription opioids and pressuring doctors to reduce or cut off patients from pain meds has deprived patients of necessary pain relief, with numerous reports of pain patients turning in desperation to the black market or worse, to suicide after being taken off the opioids that have contained their pain for years. At the same time, current opioid policy has driven up the overdose rate by driving non-medical users to more dangerous alternatives as the supply of diverted prescription opioids has trickled down to, according to the DEA in 2019, quote, less than 1% of the total quantity of controlled substances that is distributed to retailers. In summary, blaming the overdose rate on bad behavior, careless choices, devilish doctors, or corrupt chemical companies just evades the truth. The great bulk of damage done by non-medical drug use is the result of drug prohibition. And until we end drug prohibition, the overdose rate will inexorably increase. Thank you.
Five minutes to rebuttal, Adrian. You want to take the podium, or you can take it. 5 minutes.
Okay, so there are a number of statements that have been made. One of the statements was that Nora Volkow, the head of the National Institute on Drug Abuse, has said that addiction is rare. Well, in an interview where she was asked to put a number to that, she said 8%, and that an 8 to 12% is the number that is on the National Institute of Drug Abuse website, and is the number that I quoted as well, 8 to 12%. So the head of NIDA does not think that the addiction rate is 1%. She has said that it is 8%. The Cochrane reviews were mentioned as well. These are usually systematic reviews of randomized controlled trial. However, the Cochrane review that was mentioned here was bizarrely a review of 26 studies, only one of which was a randomized controlled trial, and that wasn't placebo controlled. It was just comparing two opioids. The 25 other studies were case series and uncontrolled studies, and those are completely unreliable. And 16 of those studies didn't actually report any addiction rate. They didn't say whether any of the patients had become addicted or not. Two of them reported 3%, a 3% addiction rate. So that 0.22% is completely misleading. The Cicero study was also mentioned, that 33%, the number of people, the percentage of people who start with heroin has gone up over time from 8% to 33%. That's true, but that's still completely overwhelmed by the number of people who began on prescription opioids. 51% of people who go on to heroin started with oxycodone or hydrocodone, and then others started with other prescription opioids. The argument that other drugs cause withdrawal, certainly true. There are other drugs that can cause withdrawal, but you don't see people out on the street looking for beta blockers or antidepressants. They're not addicted to those drugs. Addiction is. There was also a point made about that. Yes, although 75% of opioid of overdose deaths involve an opioid, that many of those involve polysubstances. That's quite true. Sometimes people might combine benzodiazepines like Valium, for example, with opioids, and that actually really increases the risk of death. So certain drugs like benzodiazepines, when combined with opioids, increase the risk of death. However, benzodiazepines on their own have a very low, much lower rate of death. It's the opioid that's killing people. Sometimes that polysubstance use is combining something with Benadryl. I mean, it's like if somebody pinches you and then shoots you, it's the gun that's killing you, not the pinching. So, there was also a point made that addiction is continued use despite negative consequences. Well, if you have a cooperative physician who's continuing to give you higher doses of opioids, you may not have those same negative consequences, but you're still addicted. The problem is addiction. There are different groups of people who are addicted who end up on, who are addicted to opioids. There were older urban addicts who started with heroin in the 1970s, and then there were younger people who became addicted to prescription opioids, but then were unable to continue getting those opioids from doctors, because if you're a 25-year-old healthy guy, it's hard to convince your physician to keep giving you opioids. Those patients went to the streets. They got addicted to heroin. The reason those deaths went up is because the illicit supply of opioids has become laced with fentanyl. It's become highly dangerous. The deaths are because the supply got more dangerous. It's not that prescription opioids had nothing to do with it. Many patients started on prescription opioids. They ended up on the streets looking for heroin. They are dying because the illicit opioid products have become extremely dangerous. That's what's killing people.
5 minutes, everybody.
Well, before I even get started, I think it's, you know, belittling the poly drug use as opioids with some Benadryl is really not being honest. At least half of the time it's cocaine, and about a third of the time it's methamphetamine. So, and like I say, we don't tell people now, don't make sure you don't take cocaine along at the same time. Dr. Fugh-Berman, you know, criticized a lot of these quality studies that I've cited, and Cochrane studies are the gold standard. I restrained myself, many of the claims that she made in her slide presentation, from hyperalgesia to a lot of the other so-called side effects of suicidality. These are not confirmed. These are correlations and have not been shown to have causation. And I could cherry pick as well, but I'm going to stay away from that because I want to give a couple of more important points that I didn't have the time to make in my initial presentation. Remember I told you that when I showed you that slide that it ended in 2014. Well, with changed terminology, the National Survey on Drug Use and Health reported from 2015 to 2019. And they found that pain medication misuse fell from 4.7% in 2015 to 3.5% in 2019. And that the amount of people with what they now call opioid use disorder, so it's not broken down by prescription pain pills, heroin, fentanyl, it's just opioid use disorder, that also fell from 2.5 million to 1.5 million. They also found that heroin initiation decreased by 57%. From 2018, but methamphetamine use rose 0.5% from 0.5% to 0.8% in the year 2018 to 2019. It's also important to know that the median lethal dose for oxycodone is 100 milligrams per kilogram in a rat, or 810 milligram pills if you were taking oxycodone. And the median lethal dose for hydrocodone is 375 milligrams per kilogram in a rat, or 4,077.5 milligram Vicodin pills. The National Survey on Drug Use and Health has shown that opioid prescribing peaked in the year 2012, and total opioid use in 2014 was less. Total opioid use was less in 2014 than in 2012. Now, another interesting thing, Dr. Fugh-Berman correctly shows we're number one in the world in opioid prescribing. Germany is number two, and they rank second only to us, and their prescription volume rate kind of tracks closely with ours. It picked up in the late 90s, it peaked in 2012, and it's coming down just like ours is. And interestingly, they reported that their addiction rate has been unchanged for this entire century. But another thing that differentiates them from us, even though like us, the opioid prescribing didn't increase the addiction rate, but their overdose rate is among the lowest in the world. And that's because since the late 1980s, Germany has embraced harm reduction, from needle exchange programs to safe consumption sites to methadone and buprenorphine treatment. So that's why their overdose rate is lower. And then I'm pretty much going to finish up here, but I did want to point out that very recently in the journal Public Health Reports, which is put out by the Surgeon General's Office in 2019, a study was done that spanned the years 2013 and 2015, where in the Massachusetts Department of Health and Boston University, they used the prescription drug database, and they linked it up with toxicology reports. And they found, quote, only 1.3% of decedents had an active prescription of each opioid detected in a toxicology report on a date of death. So again, this all basically adds weight to my argument that we have a growing population of non-medical drug users. When opioids were prescribed more liberally, that made for more opioids to be diverted into the black market for non-medical use. And now that's no longer available, they've moved on to other things. Meanwhile, the people who need it are being given things like Tylenol, which multiple studies have now shown is the same as placebo. Or they've been putting on dangerous drugs like NSAIDs, which can cause kidney failure, bone marrow depression, and ulcers. Thank you.
Thank you to you both. We now go to the Q&A section of the evening, and I see people lining up at the mic to ask their questions. I'm going to be honoring questions from the streamers and also asking for questions from the audience, but then as well, both debaters have the right to ask each other a question at any time. Would either of you debaters like to exercise that right at this time? Jeff, make sure your mic is near your mouth. Ask your question.
Yeah, I'd like to ask Dr. Fugh-Berman. So based upon the resolution that opioid overtreating with opioids caused the overdose crisis, would you then advocate, or would you then say that if we completely stopped all opioid prescribing, got it down to zero, the overdose rate was going to start to come down?
If we were, I mean, it's unreasonable to think that the opioid prescribing rate would come down to zero because, of course, some opioid prescribing is perfectly legitimate for end-of-life care, for cancer-related pain, et cetera. But yet, over-prescribing has fed this epidemic and will continue to feed this epidemic. There's a bit of a lag. It's about 8 years. One study found that it's about 8 years from when someone starts prescription opioids to when they start using heroin. But the epidemic that we have here is an addiction epidemic, and it is. And then when people end up on the street, that's when they're being exposed to these dangerous drugs. So yes, absolutely. If we were to lower the rate of opioid prescribing, it would also lower. It would also lower the risk of addiction and of overdose.
Okay, because the data show that the prescribing rate has come down. The prescription volume has come down close to 60% since 2011. And the overdose rate has soared. So you're saying if we bring it down to, let's say, 2%, that's going to make like a hairpin turn and start coming down? I just want to make sure I understand.
So heroin, fentanyl really entered the market about 2014, and that's when you really start to see deaths go up. The problem is that fentanyl has made the illicit market for opioids much more dangerous. That is the problem. And the question that I have for you, I know that you are on the record saying that prescriptions are government-mandated permission slips and that drugs should just be available. Do you believe that that potent opioids such as oxycodone and heroin should be available over the counter?
Yes, absolutely. I think that adults shouldn't have to get permission from another adult to put something into their body. And it's, of course, if we had a legal market, then we see overdose rates come down dramatically because we'd have accountability and it'd be the market and the tort law would regulate drugs.
Okay, yes, all right. By the way, you guys can exercise the same right to ask each other a question at any time, but I want to get some audience questions. Again, please phrase your question as a question. No need to identify yourself. Take it away, sir. What's your question?
Dr. Fugh-Berman, we heard a number of figures. What would you say is the percentage of naive opioid painkiller users who become addicted?
The number of naive, so somebody who starts on opioids? The general number that's accepted is about 8 to 12% of people who start on opioids.
Oh, excuse me. Speak into the mic, sir. Let him talk to him into the mic. Hold the mic up to his mouth, please. Let him make his comment.
How many people in this room have taken an opioid painkiller? Raise your hand.
Okay, now you don't have to ask a question of the audience.
How many of you became addicted?
Okay, thank you for
your... What the hell is the matter with you?
Okay, thank you.
What's the matter? Tell me why you didn't become addicted.
Okay.
Did you take that medication?
Yeah, thank you for your question, sir. Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Next question, please.
That's like going after the Animal Act on the Johnny Carson show. My name is Josh Bloom from the American Council on Science and Health, and our motto is we debunk junk. And I'm sure you know and dislike many of the 100 articles and op-eds I've written about our particular slant on what's going on with opioids in this country. I just want to call you out on one number, and that was the 103,000 overdose deaths in whatever it was, 2020, 2019.
A little closer to his mouth, please, a little closer to his mouth.
Yeah. Okay. I've called people out in writing for playing a trick, and that trick is combining the legal pill prescriptions with fentanyl to come up with a number that is artificially high, and it would be like combining submarine and automobile accidents to describe how dangerous transportation was. It gives, my question is, are you aware that this number of 103,000 is misused to paint a different picture than is really going on, because fentanyl, of course, most of that. So that's my question.
Fentanyl is the illegal drug. I guess the question is addressed to Dr. Fugh-Berman. Take it away, Dr. Berman.
So the number is actually over 107,000 overdose deaths in 2021. That's the CDC, Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. A number that includes overdoses from not just opioids, but of all drugs, including methamphetamine, including cocaine, et cetera. So the 75% were due to an opioid. Many of those are due to fentanyl. There's a very dangerous illicit fentanyl supply, and that's not the least bit misleading, since, as I've explained, the people who are dying from fentanyl are using heroin, and they're using heroin because many of them started off with prescription opioids and then had to go to the streets to get heroin. I will also point out that the American Council on Science and Health is very heavily industry funded.
Dr. Singer, Jeff, do you have a comment?
I'd just like to say that I would think you would agree with me on this, that we use the term opioids too loosely, because opioids is a category of drugs that involve either a derivative of the opium poppy, those are opiates, or they've been modified slightly chemically, those are opioids, or they could be completely synthetic opioids. So it's a whole class of drugs. And when the general public hears opioids, they're thinking the ones that the doctors prescribe. But in fact, as you pointed out, there were close to 108,000 overdose deaths this last year. And that included deaths from cocaine, methamphetamine, benzodiazepines, the whole works. Out of that, around 77,000 were from that big, broad class of opioids. But Dr. Blum makes a very valid point, because 89% of them contain fentanyl. 89% of those 77,000 overdose deaths contain fentanyl. And actually, 25% of the 77,000 overdose deaths had methamphetamine, and 26% had cocaine. So saying, I think this is, and this is not your fault, I'm saying this is a fault we've all made. We gotta tighten up the nomenclature and be more specific, because we create this impression out there that all opioids are causing these deaths, and it's really the street opioids.
All opioids are addictive. All opioids can cause death, and prescription opioids lead to street drug use.
I have a couple of questions for streamers. Dr. Adrian, the question had to do with your point about opioids not treating pain, and I think you said they're not much better than placebo. And could you give more information on that?
Sure. There are many studies, and there have been systematic reviews that have been done. Opioids don't work well for chronic pain. They do work for acute pain, but we're finding out more and more that that you can use other drugs to treat acute pain. I mean, I would have said a few years ago, if you have a kidney stone, please give that person opioids. Like that, it's really horrible pain. And opioids, but it turns out that actually non-steroidal anti-inflammatories can also work for kidney stone pain. I think that's amazing. And by the way, although Tylenol, acetaminophen, it's a very weak painkiller. I completely agree with you that it's a very weak painkiller. It actually can be extremely effective when it's combined with a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. It can actually increase the effect of the NSAID. So it's kind of a magic combination, combining ibuprofen or another NSAID with Tylenol, even though the Tylenol on its own is really quite weak. So, this comes out of dental research and other acute pain research. So, and it's not true that they're more dangerous than opioids. There are about 16,500 deaths from non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs compared to 100,000 opioid deaths. And by the way, even the deaths that are attributed to NSAIDs, even that's an exaggeration, because sometimes they include all gastrointestinal bleeding deaths as possibly being related to NSAIDs. Anyway, I just to get into the weeds, but NSAIDs are not more dangerous than opioids. I hope I've demonstrated to you how dangerous opioids are.
Anybody can comment the question, Jeff. You don't have to ask me. Any comment from you,
Jeff?
Yeah,
I think you've fallen into that opioid trap again that we just talked about. You're right, 16,000 some and change
deaths due to NSAIDs, 13,000 and change deaths due to prescription opioids in the latest numbers. So NSAIDs actually kill more people than prescription opioids. That's number one. Number two, if I have a kidney stone and anybody is there, please give me opioids. And I also don't want Tylenol, which can kill my liver, and it's very dangerous. In fact, you could, the restrictions on how much you take a day, because it's much more dangerous than opioids, which don't kill,
speaking of the mic,
cause encephalopathy, yes, don't cause cardiomyopathy, don't cause pancreatitis.
You just said Tylenol is more dangerous than opioids?
Pardon me? Did I say Tylenol is more dangerous than opioids? No, I think if you take too much Tylenol, you could damage your liver.
Agree with that.
Next question. Questions for Dr. Singer. You had mentioned that this is a prohibition problem. Is there any evidence for, are there other countries that don't have prohibition, and would any statistics kind of back up the claim from those countries?
Actually, unfortunately, there's no country that has ended drug prohibition, but there are a couple of countries that have kind of done pretty decent halfway steps. For example, in 2001, Portugal, at that time, had the highest overdose death rate from street drugs in the entire European Union. They decided to decriminalize drugs. So they no longer arrested people for drug use, and they stopped stigmatizing people who were using street drugs, and they were putting all their efforts that were going into law enforcement and put it into harm reduction type programs like needle exchange programs and those kind of things. They now have the lowest overdose death rate in Europe, and interestingly, they have a lower teen drug use rate than the rest of the European Union countries. They have an adult drug use rate of about the same as the rest of Europe. The problem with decriminalization is you still got to get your drugs on the black market, so you still don't know what's in it. And so it's certainly better than putting people in cages because they chose to use a substance that's different than what you choose to use to alter your mental consciousness. But the problem is you're still making them have to use stuff that you don't know what's in it.
Comment from you, Adriane, another question?
Oh, yeah, I just want to say that I really agree with Dr. Singer about harm reduction techniques, that the importance of them in Portugal, and that we should be using harm reduction techniques more in the U.S. So.
Great. I have a question from a streamer. I guess the logic of it is mainly addressed to you, Adriane. With most of the countries of focus, most of the country's focus and resources on opioids aimed at addiction and overdose numbers, shouldn't it concern everyone that no one is capturing data on untreated or undertreated pain? Is there data on untreated and undertreated pain?
Chronic pain is a really difficult issue in people. Opioids can really affect pain processing. Chronic pain is a terrible problem. We really need to have better research on chronic pain. We need to look at non-pharmacologic therapies. We need to look at over-the-counter therapies. We need to look at combinations of things. Drugs aren't the only answer. In fact, I've already said that opioids don't work well for chronic pain. The thing for which there is the most evidence from randomized controlled trials is actually exercise. It can be very difficult to get chronic pain patients to exercise, but that's actually really helpful. Other things that can be helpful are, and these are from systematic reviews that have been done by government agencies. Other things that can be helpful are spinal manipulative therapy, massage, and other kinds of things. But we need to have a lot. It's a terrible problem. Like, we need to have a lot more research on what really works for chronic pain. Opioids are not the answer.
Well, I'd just like to say, I don't treat chronic pain. I'm a surgeon, so I treat acute pain. But I'm a clinician, and like I said in my opening remarks, as you know, there's a lot of debate in the clinical research literature about the treatment of pain. And I know many well-respected academic researchers believe there is a role for opioids. Now, were opioids used way more often than he needed to be. I don't think anybody would disagree with that. But to say that it really is not helpful to treatment of chronic pain is also something you can't say, because there's a lot of evidence that in some cases it is. And that's what clinicians are always debating, because no two patients are alike, no two clinical contexts are the same. So this is one of those areas where we need a lot more research, but nobody knows the right answer yet.
There is actually no reliable evidence that opioids are effective for chronic pain. There are certainly cases in which a patient does fine on opioids and doesn't go up over years, and that helps them. But those cases are rare, and opioids should be the last thing that we try for chronic pain patients, because the adverse consequences are so severe.
Next question.
So I think this is the first debate where by the Q&A I haven't made a decision. Trying to think about blame, I know the tendency is usually to blame prescribing physicians and doctors, but what role do like government-run medical insurance companies like Medicare, Medicaid have in this? Have there been incentives or like kickbacks given that like have made physicians prescribe these more? Like where's the federal government's responsibility in this?
Please start with that question, Jeff. Yes, Jeff, take it.
You may agree with me on this. There have been incentives, Medicare particularly, when they reimburse hospitals or you know, pay hospitals or doctors, they want patient satisfaction questionnaires answered out, and that influences the payment. And so if patients say I wasn't satisfied with the control of my pain, that might affect the way Medicare remunerates providers. So there is some evidence that provided an incentive for providers to be much more liberal with the pain medicine, because they wanted to get a good write-up by the patients. But another thing I think it's important to note, again, you can't say, if a person has their pain controlled on an opioid, let's say for 10 years, and they're taking the same steady dose for 10 years, you can't say they're addicted. You can say they're definitely chemically dependent on it, but you can't say they're addicted, because it all depends on, addiction is a behavioral disorder when you have compulsive use despite negative consequences. Now you said there's no negative consequences because you're getting your pain medication, but you can't jump to the conclusion that if that person wasn't on that pain medication, they'd start using anyway despite negative consequences. And all too often, many patients, some are desperate enough to go to the black market, but some commit suicide.
Comment from you, Adrian? Another question?
Yes, but also just to that last point, opioids can cause chronic depression. There's a higher rate of suicide among opioid.
That's patients. Not proven. That's correlation, not causation.
It's absolutely been shown. But also, anyway, so I just have to say
people on opioids who are on chronic pain are chronically depressed because they're in pain.
In response to your question, I love this question because. I blame physicians less than pharmaceutical companies, opioid manufacturers. They really affected every source of information that physicians have. And not just physicians, they also affected payers. They also affected the Joint Commission on Hospital Accreditation to get them, physicians and other healthcare providers were being required to berate patients in the hospital every several hours, asking them, are you in pain? Rate your pain on this pain scale. If they rated their pain 7 or higher, they were basically required to give patients opioids because of those patient satisfaction and ratings. And I'm very happy to say that physicians, healthcare professionals for responsible opioid prescribing, or PROP, has gotten the government to take out, not to count those questions anymore on treatment of pain that were pressuring prescribers to give patients opioids in the hospital. So that actually is not being counted anymore towards hospital ratings, which is great. But that all came from opioid manufacturers. They're really much more involved.
Question from a streamer for Dr. Fugh-Berman. What is the justification for treating cancer pain with opioids, but not treating chronic illnesses like sickle cell or other chronic illnesses?
For end of life pain, opioids are absolutely the best thing. And for cancer related pain, not just for end of life pain, but for cancer related pain, there's the evidence that opioids actually work quite well. So there's just good evidence that they work. Sickle cell, of course, chronic disease and can cause exacerbations, and those are often treated with short courses of opioids, and that is certainly sometimes indicated.
Comment from you about the question and the answer?
Well, I think it's a very good question because do you have to be terminally ill to get pain relief? I mean, if there are a lot of conditions people with spinal deformities and who have had scoliosis surgery who are miserable, and they deserve pain relief too.
Absolutely, we need more research on things that will actually work without harming them.
Next question.
This is to Dr. Fugh-Berman. So, doctors are educated, smart, licensed, and yet you're suggesting that they were duped or maybe even outright bribed into overprescribing. So do you think that it's wise to have doctors or anyone serve as gatekeepers if, based on what you said, it sounds like they might not be trusted in this role?
Oh, thanks so much for asking that question. So I've written a paper with a social psychologist on how social psychology is used to manipulate physicians, and physicians may be more gullible than the general population. A lot of the techniques that pharmaceutical companies use are actually pretty conventional sales techniques. They have some specific ones as well. Most physicians don't come from they don't have a sales background. They don't come from families that have sales background. They don't, recognize these kinds of techniques. And, we're very, very smart in some ways, but we might be sort of lacking in some street smarts. What most of the education, the continuing education of physicians is funded by pharmaceutical companies. In fact, the FDA actually asked opioid manufacturers to fund continuing medical education for physicians on the safety, on prescribing opioids safely. And my group has done an analysis of this industry-funded CME. And of course, it's chock full of marketing messages. You don't ask the industry selling opioids to educate physicians on the safety of opioids. So, I think the answer here is independent education of physicians. And that is possible. There are independent drug therapeutics newsletters. FarmNow does independent CME. That's available free on the web for anybody to see. So there is industry independent, and we have lists of industry independent continuing medical education on our site. So that's what I think we need.
Carmen, I think you sell us clinicians short. You think we're that stupid that if an opioid sales rep comes to my office and gives me all these papers, maybe even gives me a pen, maybe two pens, one of these real fancy, ink pen, ballpoint pens, that all of a sudden I said, well, I'm going to start prescribing opioids at that dose to my patients because this guy gave me a pen. How could I say no after the pen? We're not that dumb. We are critical thinkers, just like research physicians are. We think too.
I'm going to have to really send you some of our papers, but
I'll have to send you some of mine.
I'll have to tell you about the social psychology experiment. So it turns out that small gifts actually work much better than big gifts. So there's a great social psychology experiment in which they had students do a really boring task. It was like moving pegs from one pegboard to the other and then twisting them or something. It was really dumb. And then afterward, they said to the students, I'll pay you to tell the next student this was interesting. So some of the students, they said, I'll pay you the equivalent of $5 to tell the next student this was an interesting experiment. And then the others, they said, I'll pay you the equivalent of $200. Later, they interviewed the students on how interesting was that task that you did. The ones who took $200 said, I just lied. I mean, $200 is a lot of money for the student. I just lied to the next student because I wanted $200. The ones who took $5 said, it was kind of interesting. Nobody
wants to be the person bought off for $5? Like, you understand being bought off a large amount of money, right? But what happens is you actually change your thinking in order to reduce that cognitive dissonance of, like, I'm not the kind of person who can be bought off by $5 or by a tuna fish sandwich. You actually change your thinking. Those small gifts are extremely effective.
What you're saying can't be proven.
There are studies, and I've done some
studies too. I've been practicing for more than 35 years as a clinician who takes care of patients and has dealt with life and death situations. I find that offensive, to be honest with you.
Well, okay. Finding data offensive.
Next question.
Dr. Singer, I'd like to project forward into the world that you were suggesting, where heroin and OxyContin and all of these drugs and new drugs that manufacturers would come up with will be available over the counter without an intellectual source advising people on the medical use of these things, so that people can go and hear whatever the manufacturer says about these companies or about their drugs and believe the advertising or not, but people will be able to use them over the counter without a control. In that world, do you think that the corporations will be able to outcompete the black market in providing drugs that addicts will use? In other words, will addicts continue to buy over the counter, or will a black market be better at marketing and selling better drugs, quote unquote, and continue to have situations like fentanyl and such? Will the black market go away?
It all depends on how the government handles it. For example, in California, where they legalized cannabis, they taxed it and regulated it so much that a lot of cannabis users in California said, screw it, I'll get a better deal from my routine dealer. I don't have to pay as much when I go to the cannabis store. And they're not going to arrest me anymore because it's now legal. So it depends. If we really allow it to be, we don't overtax or overregulate so they can compete, a rational person would much rather go into a store where they can see the labeling of the product, they can see what's in it, they can ask the person who's selling it to them questions, they can do comparison shopping, and they can also sue the manufacturer if the product, just like with alcohol, let me just use, we don't have to get a prescription to get alcohol. My drug dealer is named Total Wine. I didn't have to get a prescription. When I go to that dealer, I ask the people, I look on the bottle if it says 45% alcohol. It never even dawns on me that it may have fentanyl in it, or it may have some other arsenic, because it's legal. So the answer is yes. I think that if you legalize all drugs and allow it to be regulated and allow people to sue and have accountability like we have with alcohol, I think you'll see deaths come down, and I think it's going to be positive.
Coming from you, Dr. Adrian? Yeah. On the question? No. Okay. This question has been coming up a great deal from the streamers, and so it's somewhat repetitious. Maybe I'll first lob it at you, Dr. Singer. Why is there no data on the millions of disabled people who are now suffering? Why are there no policy groups or task forces aimed at supporting people in pain and their providers? So can you address that question?
I don't have the answer to that question. I think we're seeing more and more pain patient advocacy groups get more organized and more vocal, and more and more lawmakers are familiar with either friends or relatives who are chronic pain sufferers who are having trouble even getting, more and more doctors are refusing to treat any pain because they're just so afraid of getting in trouble with their licensing board or with the law that they're actually not seeing pain. Primary care doctors are referring people to pain management specialists rather than take on the pain patient. And then the pain management specialists are booked up so you can't get in for months, or they don't want to take new patients. So as more and more patients are getting vocal about this, I think it's going to stimulate the studies that they're asking for. But I agree that there aren't enough.
Want to address that question, Adrian? No, okay. I'm afraid we have time for just one final question. Please ask a question.
Hi, I'll be very concise, and I am an analyst at Reason, so I'll give that affiliation out there because it does have bias. Real quick, what is your evidence, Dr. Fugh-Berman, that addiction has increased over the last 20 years? The data that Dr. Singer cited, that's from the federal government. It shows pretty stable rates of heroin plus pain reliever addiction. What are the time series that show that addiction has actually increased with the prescribing?
There's plenty of evidence from the government about addiction increasing. So an addiction to the addiction rate to prescription opioids has been more stable. But as I've already said, you know, the street drugs are. People, you know, start with prescription opioids and then end up going to street drugs. We actually don't know what the rate of addiction is because there's so few people who enter treatment. You know, so we can use the number of people who enter into treatment as a proxy, but that's something that we really we need to have more data. We need to have more data on the exact numbers. There have been, you know, some small studies that have been done in Massachusetts, for example, that found that about 5% of the population has opioid overuse, has opioid use disorder. But we lack some of those national numbers.
You want to address the question?
Everybody saw the slides I put up. That's from the government. It's a flat line. And Germany's data is the same. And they're the second highest opioid prescribing country in the world.
Okay. That concludes the Q&A part of the evening. We go to the summaries. Dr. Berman, you have 7.5 minutes to summarize. Take it away.
Pharmaceutical companies created a far-reaching, highly effective campaign to convince physicians, other healthcare providers, and patients that opioids were underused, rarely addictive, and safe for long-term use. These were lies. Opioids don't work for chronic pain, and they're the most dangerous painkiller. Physicians and dentists introduced millions of patients to opioids, increasing doses over time as patients became dependent on them. When physicians became uncomfortable with the amount of opioids patients were consuming, some stopped prescribing them, leaving addicted patients to buy opioids on the street and exposing those patients to the risks of deadly forms of fentanyl. Inappropriate prescribing of opioids created and continues to create a pool of people dependent on opioids and willing to do anything to get those opioids if their medical supply is cut off. Physicians were the initial suppliers of opioids that caused the epidemic of opioid addiction that we are currently struggling with, and they're ultimately a major cause of the 2/3 of overdose deaths that are associated with an opioid. Physicians didn't do this on purpose. We were manipulated by opioid manufacturers to believe things that weren't true. We're guilty of naivete. We're guilty of being gullible. We're guilty of not defending our profession from being manipulated by pharmaceutical companies. But we physicians are guilty, nonetheless, of unleashing our current epidemic of opioid addiction and overdose on the United States.
Your summary, Jeff Singer.
I'm just going to summarize the points I made in the beginning. This isn't a medical conference, so we're not having a panel of different doctors arguing over what's the best way to treat pain and whether opioids work or don't work. The resolution is that overtreating patients with opioids causes the overdose crisis. I've already presented everyone information showing that the overdose rate has been growing exponentially at least since the late 1970s and shows no end of stopping. Some evidence suggests it started growing in 1959. I presented evidence showing that the overwhelming majority of people who use prescription opioids non-medically got them from a friend, a relative, or a dealer. I showed evidence showing that the majority of overdose, drug overdose deaths are polydrug, and that there's no reason to think that a patient who's been put on opioids by a physician suddenly feels compelled to mix them with cocaine and methamphetamine and alcohol and Xanax. And my whole thesis is that that we've had a growing population of non-medical drug users willing to take risks that in my generation non-medical drug users weren't willing to take, and there are much more dangerous drugs out there because of the iron law of prohibition. During the late 1990s, early 2000s, when doctors were prescribing opioids much more liberally, there were a lot of opioids available for diversion into the black market, and that's what was used. If anyone here remembers college days in the early 2000s, people would use OxyContin at parties, okay? And then when that source dried up, people who had developed habits, or not even necessarily a habit, they were recreational users. So they went looking for it, and they got either counterfeit OxyContin, that was really fentanyl, or they started using whatever was more available. This has always been a prohibition crisis, and I'm gonna end the way I opened, which is in the 70s and 80s and early 90s, when people were dying of overdose deaths then, we blamed it on them. We said they were immoral and they were making bad life choices. But then when it started involving white middle class people in the late 90s, early 2000s, we blamed it on the greedy pharmaceutical companies and the doctors who were manipulated. It's always been about drug prohibition, and it's going to get worse until we recognize it.
Thank you, Adriane, and thank you, Jeff, for a very civil, albeit very spirited exchange. Jane, please open the final vote. Yes, no, or undecided. America's overdose crisis is the result of doctors overtreating patients with opioids. It looks as though Jane has the results, and I have here in my hand the Soho Forum Tootsie Roll that goes to the winner of this debate. A Soho Forum Tootsie Roll of great value, of course. Jane, please give me the results, okay? The resolution read, the overdose crisis is a result of doctors overtreating patients with opioids. The yes vote went from 31.4% to 39.5%. That was the yes vote. It picked up 8.14 points. That's the number to beat. Well, the no vote went from 37.21% to 45.35%. It also picked up 8.14 points. We have to divide this Tootsie Roll among you two. However, because Adrian, you're going to have to go on the road, we give you the Tootsie Roll. Jeff, she's going to get the Tootsie Roll.